Hello, everybody. Thank you for coming. My name is Markos. This is Nirmoy. We both work for SUSE. We are in the network team. And as far as our openSUSE contribution goes, then we maintain open vSwitch and DPDK. Today, we're going to show you how you're going to use these technologies, basically, to improve your network performance. We try to keep it simple. We are going to oversimplify a lot of things just to give you an idea how these technologies evolved over time. So we'll start with a brief introduction to virtualization. And we'll talk briefly about Open vSwitch and DPDK. And later, Nirmoy will perform a demo bringing all this together. So traditionally, in virtualization, you have the hypervisor. Where you normally emulate the processor, the disk controller, and the NIC interface. And every hypervisor has a different driver for all these components. So there is a complication here that, in the sense that every virtualized operating system needs to have specialized drivers so it can be used with different hypervisors. This is obviously very complex and slow in terms of progress. And the good thing here is that you can run an unmodified guest operating system. However, as you can see here, basically you have virtual machines thinking that they have some sort of real hardware. But in reality, it's just a hypervisor that's emulating all the input-output communication. So as I said before, the problem here is that there are different hypervisor technologies like QEMU, VMware, which are exposing different devices. So for example, one hypervisor may be exposing an Intel network interface, another one may be exposing a Realtek. So you need separate drivers in the guest operating systems. This is getting complicated in terms of development. So the first, at first, there was this virtIO standard for developing drivers for virtualization. So this virtIO standard is basically a framework mandating how a driver needs to be developed for virtualization. There is the it's over here, right? So there is the front end, which is common. And there's the backend, which is hypervisor specific. So for example, you have the virtIO net driver, which is common in the guest operating system. And then the hypervisor implements the backend. The backend basically, you know, intercepts the front-end communication and then does on the underlying input and output operation. However, this is getting very messy and very slow, as there are too many layers from the virtual machine to the real hardware. So when the virtual machine instantiates some sort of communication, then it has to go through the virtIO driver front-end, and then through the back-end, and then through the TAMP interface, and in the end, it's the kernel that manages all the communication. Obviously, you can't use this thing in production. The ideal situation would be for the guest operating system to manage the interface directly. So we'll see how to do that later on. Another thing that complicates the situation is the thousands of millions of context switches. For those who don't know, context switch is basically when you move from user space to kernel space. And one of the things that happen during a context switch is the there is a lot of overhead because you need to preserve the user space environment, and later on you need to restore it when you return from kernel to user. So one thing we need to do is to reduce the number of context switches. After virtIO, the virtIO was improved, and this is where the vHost was born. Basically, vHost is the virtIO backend we discussed before, but this time the backend is implemented in the kernel instead of the hypervisor. As such, you no longer need so many context switches because, as we see here, the backend now is in the kernel, and basically the vert IO and the guest, they share some memory with the backend. So during the IO operation from the virtual machine, the data is being written to this part of the memory, and later on the kernel thread is reading this memory and performs all the input and output. However, we still need to cross the boundary, so there is still some latency, although it's not as bad as it used to be. So there is this concept of vHost user. In this context, the vHost is now moved from the kernel to the user space. So there is no longer the need to have context switch for reading the data from the virtual machine. However, there is latency again, because the vHost user application needs to somehow send data to the tap interface. So in order to do that, you need again to cross the boundary from the kernel to from the user to the kernel space. So having said all that, I'm stepping a step backwards to discuss a little bit of Open vSwitch. This basically a virtual switch which supports many common technologies in the managed switch area, like the OpenFlow. You can do VLAN, spanning tree protocol, and then you can also have tunnels in the Open vSwitch. Maybe OpenFlow is something new to you. So the way we use it is, it's like a protocol where you use it to program the switch. If any of you have used the managed switch in the past, what happens normally is you log into the command line interface of the managed switch, and then you program the ports. For example, you know, this port is belongs to this VLAN, this MAC address should be blocked to this port and everything. So you can do the same things with OpenFlow. OpenFlow is supported in Open vSwitch and many hardware switches, so it's sort of the industry standard for managing the switches these days. Open vSwitch has many components, two of which is the kernel module and the user space switch. Basically, the switch functionality and logic and implementation is in the user space. The kernel module is just a cache, right? So the first packet that arrives in Open vSwitch goes through the user space. The user space knows what to do with this packet because you used OpenFlow or something else to program the logic behind Open vSwitch. And after that, the remaining packets all go through the kernel module. So you don't need to cross the kernel user space boundary anymore. The kernel module communicates with the user space application through netlink. So the user space application can always change the cache or invalidate the cache or update the cache as necessary. For most of the things that you do with virtual machines, Open vSwitch can be considered a drop-in replacement of the Linux bridge. So you just replace all your Linux bridges with Open vSwitch, and then everything normally works, because the default behavior for Open vSwitch is to behave like a regular level 2 switch. So over here, as we see, there is again the problem of context switches, because all the data plane is in the kernel. So every time we send a packet from the virtual machine to the external world, then we need to cross this boundary. So one may think that it could be helpful to move all the data plane to user space to avoid this latency. However, this is not always simple. Implementing a data plane in the user space could be very complex. And usually there are quite a few bugs there. If you move the data plane to the user space, then again somehow you need to talk to the real hardware, which is normally managed by the kernel, and then again you have to cross the boundary, which is not acceptable if you want to have line rate performance. Maybe you've heard of PCI pass through in the past, where you can assign a real hardware to the virtual machine. So in PCI pass-through, for example, you can assign a graphics card to the virtual machine, or you can assign your network card to a virtual machine. This normally works, but there are a few problems here. If you do that, you can no longer use this device in your real host, and you can no longer use this device with any other VM. The relationship here is exclusive. I mean, one VM per device, which is not very cost effective. I mean, you could have like 12 network cards and 12 virtual machines, but this is not normally the best way to do it. Fortunately, hardware progressed over these years, and software followed with the virtual function input-output. In this case, the hardware exposes virtual functions. What this means is that you have a very normally a very expensive network card, where the functionality of the network card is being exposed in virtual blocks. And then you can assign these virtual blocks to a virtual machine. So you have one network interface and perhaps 12, 32, 64 virtual functions. So in the reality, you can have 64 virtual machines sharing the hardware. And they talk to the hardware directly. There are no intermediates anymore. So they do stuff like DMA and this is also what is known as SRIOV. So if we make use of this technology, then we can effectively move the hardware to user space. I mean, if you logically think about it, because now the user space can use the vFIO protocol to talk to the hardware directly, so there is no kernel involvement anymore. There is one famous user of this vFIO virtual function I/O and vHost user, which is DPDK, and Nirmoy will tell you a bit more about it.
So, what was the problem we were talking? Give me a second. Oops. So, with vHost user or like the previous solutions, it's always they always talk with the hardware. But we could really improve the performance if virtual machine can directly talk with the hardware rather than go through kernel. So to solve this problem, we have something called DPDK. Second. Oh, damn it. So what is DPDK is trying to do is so it's a library that we could use for receive and transmit packets. So it just gives normal APIs to receive or even transmit or any networking related work, and the normal programmer can use those API to write any sort of software router or software switch. Another thing DPDK does is try to use all the architectural feature to improve the performance. So we'll see. Okay. Why we really need DPDK? Okay, this should be the first slide I should talk about. So network, all the NICs these days are really moving really fast. So we have like 100 Mbps, and then now we have like 100 Gbps. For 100 Gbps, if we want to receive a packet of, let's say, 1.5K, we have only like 123 nanoseconds, which is really, really tight. And if you really reduce the frame size to, let's say, 84, for even 10 Gbps, we have only 67 nanoseconds. To compare it, let's say we have a 3 gig CPU, which means 200 CPU cycles. But even if we have single cache miss, it might take, let's say, 32 nanoseconds, and then in case of 10 Gbps and a very low frame size, we might just one cache miss just eat up the half of the time that we have. So DPDK tries to solve all those problems using. So what it does is it uses polling. So generally, kernel everything it does is throw interrupt. Interrupt is really good if we want to utilize the CPU, but it's not really good for performance. So what DPDK does, it just polls for the new packet, and it just burns CPU, and then try to get maximum performance out of it. It also uses user space. So DPDK runs in user space, so there is no context switch. So with VFIO, previously that Markos explained, so with VFIO, we could expose those NIC hardwares into the user space, and DPDK tries to access those hardware from the user space and directly write packets into the NIC. So there is no in-between kernel or any middleman. Another thing DPDK uses is a huge page. So with huge page, so there is no TLB thrashing. So if we use normal kernel, which use, let's say, 4K page, and then we do a lot of DMA and stuff, there might be a TLB thrashing in case of if we have really fast NIC. With huge page, we could have, let's say, 1 gig of huge page, and it's pretty much enough for a normal NIC. So that's the third problem DPDK solves. Another problem is pthread affinity. So in case of kernel, let's say the interrupt receiving core is core 0, but then the application is waiting in, let's say, core 3. So the interrupt handler need to notify the application that runs on core 3. So which means it's not a cache local. So data was in core 0, and then it needs to go to the core 3. It's possible to solve in kernel as well with pthread affinity, and DPDK pretty much does the same thing. Okay, so let's look how open vSwitch with DPDK looks like. So before the user space data path, it was there in the kernel. And with DPDK, everything moved into user space now. And we have PMD, which is pole mode driver. And there are pole mode driver for every sort of NICs, mostly. They support a lot of NICs, actually. So with pole mode driver, the open vSwitch can directly write the packet into the NIC. So there is no kernel intervention. It just directly goes to the NIC. All right. So if we put together everything, so we have guest OS, and we have a DPDK interface, and we have open vSwitch, which is compiled with DPDK. So there's the open vSwitch bridge. All right, yeah. So the guest OS can now actually, if we do PCI pass-through, and then we run DPDK, so guest OS technically could directly write into the hardware. With this case, when guest, there will be not a lot of copies, there will be at least one copy to the OVS, from the guest to OVS. Yeah. Okay, let's show some demo. So first demo would be like I'll run two virtual machines, and I'll run IPERF on them. So in the first one I'll use tap interface for the virtual machines, and then in the second one I'll use vhost user with DPDK. I'll just show how the performance differ. Let's see. So this is the first one where I'm running two virtual machines, and they are connected with tab interface. All right, so this is that's how I created those two VM. Okay, we could take some time. Okay, so I started the IPERF server. And that's the client. So we are getting around 2 Gbps. Let's run it again. So this is what we get with tap interface. I mean, so it's running on my laptop. So this, if we have really powerful machine, this numbers might be more. Now I'll start the second demo where we run virtual machines, and I use vHost user for Nick. I mean, when you create interface in openVSwitch, it creates a socket, and we have to give the socket in the chemo, so that they can all the control communication can happen. So all the number that we are getting, it could be more tuned. We could use multi-queue in the interface, or we could use more memory. So these are just normal demonstration, but it can be tuned to have more performance. Okay, let's see. Well, so it's at least giving more than 2 Gbps with vHost. So yeah, I mean, this number goes like 8 or 9, but I think my machine is pretty much hogged. So that's why it's not so high from tap interface, but it could grow more. Okay, so that's demo one. So in the second demo, I'll try to show how DPDK can be used to build a normal software switch. So I have 2 bridge and 3 virtual machines. So virtual machine 1 and virtual machine 2 will try to communicate with each other through IPERF. And I'll connect those 2 bridge with another virtual machine that runs DPDK L2 forward. So it just takes the packets and forwards to another port. So, and vice versa. So any packet that coming from bridge 0, it just push it to bridge 3. And same for the bridge 3 to bridge 0. Okay, so this is the machine that runs DPDK L2 forward. So you could see there are two vertio based interface that from bridge 0 and bridge 3. So I'll just assign those interface to VFIO, VIO PCI, so that DPDK could map those hardware register into user space. All right, so this is the application. So it says it runs on like 4-core and it's not doing any updating of the Mac. And we are giving a port mask 3, so it has two interface. So if you convert 3, so we have the service 3. Let's start it. All right, so even with one extra layer, it's kind of similar performance like tap interface. So all the packets are going through another intermediate VM, and this I think looks still better than the tap interface. So, and you could see those some statistics. So yeah, that's about the demos, if you guys have some question. Not really fast. I mean, it's kind of similar, but there is a intermediate VM involved, so it's still okay. I mean, all those numbers will be different if we run it on real hardware. This is on my laptop, it's pretty bad. Any questions, or we could close the session? Okay, thanks a lot. Thanks a lot for coming.